Welcome, Liam's Library. Sorry. I've been reading Thinner by Richard Bachman, but it's what I've been watching that I wanted to talk to you about. Anybody out there got CBS All Access? Well, Stephen King has a new series out. I don't know if you've been catching it. I just finished episode 5. My plan was to not talk about it. Like, I read the book, like, over and over and over again when I was a teenager. I read it heaps when I was in my 20s. I went back and read the original version of it in, like, my late 20s. We're talking, of course, about The Stand. Stephen King's The Stand. Book was released in 1979, but they cut a whole shitload of pages out because they weren't letting Stephen King, you know, over-publish at the time. They were like, no, you can cut 500 pages out of this toe-breaker of a brick you've given us. So we agreed. And he cut out, like, 400 or 500 pages of it. And when I was younger, I'd never read the original version of The Stand. I'd only read the full, complete, and uncut edition that came out in 1990, I think. And I read it over and over. And I always wonder what they kept out of the old book, because it was cut down. Like, I reckon it was cut over half. Stephen King reckons he took out 400 pages, but the copy of The Stand I read was 1,421 pages. But the original paperback is about 500-600 pages. So you help me with the maths there, because it never fucking added up to me. Anyway, there's a reason I'm talking about this, and it's not for me to talk about the book The Stand. Man, I'll tackle that Adonis next year. Maybe the year after. I've read it that many times. The only time I'm going to read The Stand again is for y'all. You know, just so I can talk about it to you. So, the reason this video exists is because I just finished episode 5 of the new version of The Stand on CBS All Access. And I've got to say, there is some stuff I fucking love about it. And there is some stuff that, you know, what the actual fuck. But before we get started, let me tell you something. If I had started this channel, Liam's Library, in my teenage years or in my 20s, there was no such thing as YouTube back then, so I couldn't. But let's just say hypothetically I did. I would have just loved everything. The Stand is the best thing ever written. The Shining is the greatest fucking ghost story ever written. Pet Sematary is the best horror novel ever written. And, like, if you had a different opinion, I'd fucking go off and I'd try to tell you 1,000 reasons why you were wrong. Man, I don't have the energy for that anymore. Not to mention, these days, I see a lot of holes in King's stuff. It's still not to say he's, like, not my fourth favourite author. He fucking is. He's still fantastic. He's the reason I'm talking to you today. But, you know, he also put me onto a lot better writers than him. But it's definitely worth talking about because it's on TV right now, right? Now, whether you've read the book or whether you haven't, it's an interesting series because this last year, COVID hit the world and everybody thought we were going to get wiped out by the flu. People still think that. I live in Western Australia, so we never really got hit by it. But I believe what's going on in the world, it's a real thing. So for them to release this Stephen King series now about a flu killing the 99.6% of America, excuse me, and like 0.4% survivors are survivors and they're immune to this flu. And so what does that work out to be? About 5,000, like 20,000 people? Fuck, maybe. Anyway, these survivors in America, they start picking themselves up out of the ashes and then they start having dreams. And some of them dream about this nice old 116-year-old black lady who plays guitar and lives out in a cornfield out there in Nevada, and it's called Hemingford Home. The bad guys, you motherfuckers out there that like to hurt people, sadists and sickos, y'all are dreaming about the dark man. His name is Randall Flagg, and he lives in Vegas. He's in the West, and if you're bad, that's where you're going. But if you're good, you're heading to Nevada, because these dreams have the feeling of prophecy. So that's where we're heading. Now, I'm not here to talk about the book. So let's straight away start with episode one of The Stand on CBS. Now, in the book, the first thing you see when you turn open the page, before you get to a Stephen King sentence, it's a song. And it's a song by the Blue Oyster Cult, and it's Don't Fear the Reaper. And it just fits so well in with the whole theme of the novel. Now, in 1994, when Mick Garris decided he would direct a miniseries of The Stand, it starts off with the Blue Oyster Cult playing Don't Fear the Reaper while this camera slow pans over this whole facility of people that have instantly died, like died in their soup, died at their computers. And like, it's kind of corny, but the song doesn't make it corny. And there's just a crow on the fence outside. And those of you like myself who read the book were like, holy shit, that crow's the Dark Man. And fuck, that's just like in the book. And fuck yeah, what a great start to this. Like, Don't Fear the Fucking Reaper. Huge, right? So, first episode of The Newsstand on CBS. We meet Fran, we meet Harold, who in the book, we do meet them right at the start. And we meet this guy named Stuart. Now, Stuart is immune. Fran and Harold are immune. All these characters we're going to be talking about in this video, they're survivors, right? So they don't know why they're immune. It doesn't really fucking matter. The first part of the book is the flu. Then they start having dreams. Then they all start to fucking build a society. Then it's the stand and they have to go fight the bad guy, right? So it's like a four-part book, really, technically. And when they made the miniseries, it was a four-part miniseries in 1994. Now, straight away with this one, it starts in the middle. And then it flashes back to the start. And then you know that's what you're going to get. If we're going to have 9 episodes on CBS and you're going to start already with jumping back and forth, we know the whole series is going to be like that. And those of us who have sat through that journey of that book, it's so important to get to the end when it becomes the stand, because you've already gone through the plague, the dreams, the killings. Now it's the stand, you know? But they're starting at like, oh yeah, the stand and the middle, and they're already in Vegas. Let's go back to where the flu was. Hey, where were you when you first found out about the flu? And it's just all over the fucking place, right? Which, when I first saw it on Facebook, people were having a hard time with that. I didn't think it would bother me. Now it does. Now after episode 5, it does. It's like, you know what? There's only 4 episodes left. You have, in 5 episodes, you haven't built up shit. I don't feel like any of them are worthy to go and walk with no food and water and just go to Vegas. Who the fuck's worthy? Fuck. Stu Redman is supposed to be the most powerful character in this book. It's played by James Marsden. And mate, he's a good actor. But he's just being James Marsden. It's like he fell asleep at the end of Sonic and thought he'd wake up and just piss out the stand. Come on, bro. Gary Sinise played Stu Redman in the 1994 version. And even when you read the book, you picture Gary Sinise. He's such a good fucking actor. Especially when he's playing your main guy who you don't fuck with, who's got a good heart and he's very smart. Fucking Gary Sinise. Give it to James Marsden. Perfect. But come on, Marsden. Be fucking Stu. Anyway. One of the characters you'll meet in episode 1 is Harold Lauder. Harold Lauder. I always say Lauder, but whatever. Now, he's this creepy fucking senior fucking, you know, like he's like a teenager, you know, 80. It's hard for me to work out teenagers in Stephen King books because all you guys in America, you just go to school at different times than we fucking do. So, yeah, so to me, Harold's like 17 in my head. So in this new TV series, they get this actor named Owen Teague to play Harold. Now, Harold is this creepy fuck who's been spying on his neighbor for fucking fucking 15 years with his dick in his hand. He's that creepy computer guy with pimples. He thinks he's a writer. There's shit going on with him. He's an outcast and, you know, there's probably a reason for that. The old actor that played him, I can't remember his name, but in the 1994 miniseries, the guy that played Harold was just fucking amazing. He was just so awkward, so trying to be authoritative that it was like, fuck, man. Like, Harold's jumping out of the page with this guy. Now, with this newsstand, everybody else, it's like they're snoring and sleeping through their fucking lines. Episode 1, Harold, his Owen Teague, this guy Owen Teague, just kills it. Like, just fucking kills it, right? And now, that's enough. That was enough to get a lot of people on Facebook on board. They were like, man, well, hey, Harold's fucking perfect, right? Franny sucks. Stu's okay. you know, I don't really like this back and forth shit, but hey, Harold's unreal. Now, we go down the track, right? And there's episode 2, episode 3. People didn't like episode 3 and 4, whatever. I had problems with a lot of stuff, and I didn't have a problem with certain other stuff. But when you get to episode 5, and Harold just evolves into just even a better Harold. So he's surrounded by these fucking actors that you know are in actual Hollywood movies. And they're snoozing through their fucking lines. Like standing right next to Owen Teague doing a read. And then Owen Teague pulls his fucking face and just like be's the fucking craziest Harold that Christian Bale couldn't even dream of acting that fucking hardcore. And the rest of them are still snoring their lines. It's not taking me out of it because I'm just all about this now. Harold is just fucking perfect. And I just want to watch Owen Teague movies now. So, like, at the start, I thought I'd find a way to fault him later. But then at the end of episode 5, he's just grinning at his computer like a fucking maniac. And then that song starts playing that was just playing when I started my video. And his grin gets even wider. And it's like, fuck yeah, I want to watch the rest. Because those of us who have read the book, we know what Harold's going to do. It's pretty heavy and it's huge. I'm not going to spoil that shit. But, I had to keep going back to Owen Teague. It's probably half the reason I made this video. The rest of it really wasn't really worth talking about. Now, like I said, the book starts with Don't Fear the Reaper. The TV show starts with Don't Fear the Reaper. Now, this new TV show doesn't start with Don't Fear the Reaper. I can't even really properly remember exactly what song it starts with because it's so all over the place, right? I can tell you all about the book and that, but that's not the case. But in this, right at the end of episode 5, just as I was about to hit stop and start talking to you guys, Harold's looking at his computer and Don't Fear the Reaper kicks in. It's like, wow, you waited 5 episodes to give us Don't Fear the Reaper? It worked. I fucking love it where it is with Harold grinning at us like a fucking scary prick because he's a scary prick. Now, let's just have a quick dig at the rest of these characters. Franny was played by, what's her face from Breakfast Club? Molly Ringwald in the 1994 one. And a lot of people hate her whiny bullshit. But to me, she's Franny. Like, but Franny's a lot younger in the book than Molly Ringwald. But this Franny they've got, she's got the same teeth as Molly Ringwald. Now, why would that be something that you would have to... It's like, hey, she doesn't look anything like Molly Ringwald. She's actually a pretty terrible actress and doesn't get this character Franny at all. But her weird... front teeth have them weird spaces between them, like Molly Ringwald's did, so we'll give her the role? What the fuck? Franny's a huge part of it. She sucks in this. Now, Larry Underwood is okay, but in the book, he's okay. In the old miniseries, I like him, man. He's sitting on the bonnet of that car playing fucking Edge of Destruction, and he's Larry. Like, he's Larry. Like I had no problem with the race part of it. Like, you know, an African American actor is playing Larry in this one, but he's just like, he's likable. He's fucking gorgeous, but he's just some guy. And I suppose Larry kind of is like that in the book. Mother Abigail. Now Whoopi Goldberg is playing Mother Abigail in this. Now, when this fucking show first starts, this one on CBS, she does this big God speech. Now, in the book, that's Mother Abigail's angle. She does her big God speeches and she's, you know, and when I first press play, I'm like, holy shit, this is going to be perfect. She's even kind of doing the Mother Abigail voice. You hadn't seen Whoopi Goldberg yet. You could only hear her. And she's talking about, this is what God has planned for you. And it's like, fuck yeah. Just like in the book, it is. It's God versus the devil. Like, it's Stephen King, like blatantly telling you, yeah, good and bad. But the woman who played it in the old one, she has a guitar like in the book and she acts old. And she's just so nice. Like, y'all welcome here. You come back and bring all your friends. And Whoopi in this one, episode 5, she's like, you know, Larry, come play me some music. What would God said this? God said that. It's like, it's Whoopi. And I'm glad she's kind of pushing the old lady thing. But where's the fucking, where's like the help us to stand? Like the actual acting. They're fucking phoning it in, man. Harold, Owen Teague isn't, but the rest of them, they're all fucking phoning it in. Except whoever is playing, you know, the autistic guy, whatever his name is. He has a mental impairment. His name is Tom Cullen in the book and Tom Cullen this show. Whoever's playing him, people got angry with that. He's fucking perfect. Have you read the book? Lols, yes. He's just fucking perfect. M-O-N. And when Abigail said that as she walked off, M-O-N, that spells something. I was like, yeah, that's cool, right? But think about it this way. If you watch the old Mick Garris miniseries, it has a lot of back stuff. So you get M-O-N. Like, you know what I mean? You get, like, the little things that he's putting in. Like, who gives a fuck if, you know, that woman who's guarding Mother Abigail's house in this CBS series. Now, in the book, that's a man, right? And we get to find out, like, about him a bit. So now, like, we get there to Mother Abigail's place, and we meet this woman with the gun on her hip, and we're just believing that that's this character. Okay. Fucking, I reckon 70% of people out there never read this fucking book. Like, you can't just make it fan service. I should be happy because there's quite a bit of fan service. But if you were to watch this on your own, wanting to know, like, oh, hey, cool, like Stephen King done a story about the flu and the end of the world. It's like, what's all this extra stuff that gets no explaining? All this stuff that's left floating in the wind, we know because we read the book and we watched the miniseries over and over. But how dare you get 9 fucking full episodes and cut out all the important shit and just leave in some basic average shit. Now, okay, so that was okay. I've talked about Tom. I've talked about Mother Abigail. Now I want to talk about Flag. Alexander Skarsgård plays Flag. Skarsgård. Alexander Skarsgård. And he's got the blue eyes and he's got the, you know, the blue jeans and the chambray and that. And I think he's really good. Thing is, what I liked about old Flag was he was, like, in the old 94 miniseries, was he acted like the Flag in the book. Like, he said shit and he was, like, real southern and just like... This new one, Alexander's fucking brilliant. And what I like, what he does get right, is whenever the Dark Man fucking gets something wrong or makes a wrong decision or someone fucking does something, he gets real shitty, man. He doesn't have the patience of like a Hannibal Lecter or something like that. He's an angry fucking bad guy. And if you piss him off, he'll kill you. And if he can't kill you, fuck, he's just going to get upset. Now, when I read the book, fucking originally, the first time you come across Randall Flagg, he's just a guy. The world's ending and he knows it. But it's not like he's got any inside info from the devil. He's just always been this magical dude. That's what I like about him. So that's what I like about Alexander Skarsgård in this. He's just playing a guy. You know, he doesn't come across too fucking magical because he's not the fucking devil, man. He's just Randall Flagg. Just this weird human that we're just given a, you know, I mean, and I'm not fucking talking the Dark Tower here, so don't talk to me about the 20 different fucking Flags and Martins and Merlins and fucking Walters. We'll talk about that another day because I'm very fucking aware. But we just talk about the Stand. Skarsgård's doing it okay. He's doing it okay. But his Vegas, it's like, what's so bad about it? Like, if they're building weapons, cool, but what the fuck's so bad about their Vegas? They're gambling, drinking, and having homosexual sex. It's like, and, you know, and they're trying to make a point to show that. It's like, yeah, right, like, so? Like, so that part's a little weak. I've changed a lot over the years. I you know, I've read Stephen King through my teenage years and through my 20s. And if I had started this channel then, I would have been screaming at y'all because The Stand is the best thing he ever wrote, because it's the longest thing he ever wrote. But it isn't. Like, it isn't. I'll review that book in a couple of years for you. And it'll be the last time I ever fucking read it. But I'll leave you with that, because my next review is going to be thinner and it'll be a group discussion, because I love my Stephen King book club and movie discussion. It is a great page. It allows me to just talk shit about King. But... yeah, there's 4 episodes left. And I won't be reviewing them for you. I'll just let you alone to finish it on your own. Not to mention, just quickly, in the book, there is a character named Rita Blakemore and a character named Nadine Cross. Right? Now, they're 2 different people. Larry meets one in the city and she overdoses. And then, you know, the other one is the Dark Man's concubine.
But later, Larry meets fucking Lucy. Like, you know what I mean? And, like, Larry deserves a break. So in this version on CBS All Access, instead of them making Nadine and Rita, like, one person, they've given us Rita and they've given us Nadine. But just what? Just no Lucy? It's like, okay. That kind of makes me once again say that you've made Larry fucking one-dimensional. Like, he needs that shit. I'm going to leave it with just keep watching for O&T. At the start, it wasn't enough to make me keep watching. After episode 5, just how he's killing every other actor. And they should all be ashamed of themselves how fucking lazy they're fucking being. But I'm not angry. I don't give a fuck. I can't wait to finish Thinner and talk about that. I really don't give a fuck how bad The Stand is right now. But you do. And that's okay, because it's a great book, and you should give a shit. So give them all a hard time. And don't take any shit from anyone on Facebook. If you think that fucking Mother Abigail sucks, and it's the worst franny ever, then fucking say so. Look after yourselves. Read some great books, watch some even better fucking movies, and don't take any shit from anyone.